Greetings, welcome to our show, Ghosts R N.E.A.R, where we investigate various aspects of the paranormal and paranormal research. I am your host, Keith Johnson.
I'm the co-host, Sandra Johnson.
And on this episode, we are investigating Druid's Dream in Narragansett, Rhode Island.
On location, yay!
Druid's Dream, we originally investigated that in Pyro, Parapsychological Investigation and Research Organization, back in 1973.
I have heard of it.
Yes, it was actually December 6th, 1973, that Donna, my brother Carl and I, and a couple of other members actually went down there at night and investigated the place and with flashlights. And it's interesting to go there in the day too, when you can actually see what you're doing. But it is an interesting place with an interesting history.
And our job is to go and find out more?
Find out as much as we can, and how serious he was into Druidism and what his practices actually were. Now, supposedly, I've heard that Joseph Peace Hazard actually traveled to England in the 1840s and visited Stonehenge and became very, very heavily involved in the practice of spiritualism, and that he adopted this as his religion, or maybe developed his own brand of religion. Some say that is a sacrificial altar there, and it does bear the markings of it.
Do we know if that was his primary purpose of visiting England? Was to visit Stonehenge, or was there another purpose?
I really don't know, because he was an avid traveler and an arborist too. He was a great planter of various trees. And was he a druid? Was he a spiritualist? Was it his own variation? How much was the witch's altar and the druid's dream just for a display piece? How much was it really practiced? Did he have a coven? Did he have other members of his organization practicing with him? And how far did this go? I mean, I've heard rumors, of course, of some very negative activity too, that actual, you know, ritualistic practices went on here, but of course that could all be hearsay. We don't know. But I think it's about time we at least try to uncover some of the truth about this. Hmm. Agreed?
Agreed.
Agreed. I think it's a good idea.
Yeah, I think it's worth the trip down there to actually explore the place for ourselves and see what we can from the property, and maybe interview some of the locals.
It'd be interesting to see if the police today have any stories about that. Mm-hmm. You know, about blue lights or anything else that's been going on down there.
Sure, the legend hasn't died down. If anything, it probably has picked up by now.
Right.
Okay. Well, I've lived in Rhode Island all of my life, and I've never been to this location, so.
Well, you're about to.
All righty then.
I think a lot of us are.
And when are we planning this field trip?
Let's plan it for sometime within the next couple of weeks. How's that? Before the winter sets in, while we have some good weather.
Yeah, that's a good idea. So, we're heading down 95, going to Peacedale. Who are we going to see, Nate?
We're going to the Peacedale Library to look at Joseph P. Hazard's diary/ledger. Earlier this week, I contacted the Peacedale Library, and I called the reference department, and they transferred me to Pam Kaczynski, the central services manager, and she dug up his diary in the basement and be ready for us when we get there.
Is this the original diary that we're looking at? Is it a handwritten diary?
I don't know. I haven't seen it yet.
Oh. Okay.
Is this the diary of the guy who built Druid's Dream?
Yes.
Yeah.
What's the year on this diary, anyway?
Well, he died in 1892.
The diary holds the chronicles aspects of Druid's dream, construction, history, financial accounts, activities, and much of his philosophy. And it was the years active is 1854 through 1890. And it wasn't just him that was a spiritualist. His brother was. His whole family was, to a certain extent.
Well, and remember that he grew up in a time where the spiritualist movement in the United States was really taking off. That whole Victorian age, the late 1800s, when people were getting into seances and the whole table tipping thing and things of that nature. So hopefully we can get some insight as to what was going on in his head.
It says in this document, in the early 1880s, Hazard constructed himself a tomb and a monument at the northwest corner of Hazard Avenue and Gibson Avenue. He had named this area Kendall Green after a location in England, and it marked it with engraved stone pillars. The tomb is composed of 8 3-foot tall granite pillars arranged in a 27-foot diameter circle with the central monument. The monument is gone, although the base remains. The tops of the smooth pillars are alternately convex and concave, the latter being designed to catch rainwater and attract birds.
I need to write this one down. Along with that. Yeah, on the top, right here, this stuff. In his diary, we find that Joseph Hazard may have been a little self-conscious about how he did things and how he felt. You know, he may have been a little bit insecure. He writes, I have no hesitation in stating, in my 78th year, I feel quite sure I have never done anything in my life that was entirely right, that I might have not done it without... I can't read it this way. It's too hard to read it this way. In the Rhode Island Historical Society inventory, they have listed here, which says memorandum books, and the brief they have, it says the memorandum books contain mostly a daily log of Hazard's expenses. All expenses, even as small as a penny, are recorded. The books also may contain virtually anything else. The later books, especially from 1885 and 1886, are primarily concerned with daily reports of Hazard's pocket watch, which he apparently believed was a medium for spirit communications. Have we seen that anywhere, Dave?
Not yet. Like a pendulum?
I don't know. That's all it says. But they've got box 2 folders 1 through 12. And they have, from 1842 all the way up to 1890. So yeah, Dave, this might just be one in a very long series of books.
That's what I'm thinking.
Joseph P. Hazard records that his first experience with spiritual manifestations occurred in Boston in 1854, and that I have, quote, I have ever entertained an ardent interest in all that relates to the mysterious side of the Druids. Through his avid study of mysticism and spiritualism, Hazard participated in a non-conformist transcendentalist philosophies of Rudolph Waldo Emerson and other 19th century New Englanders. His written account of the construction of Druid's dream made it clear that he firmly believed in the reality and power of spiritual intuition and thought. He also claims to have found evidence for the
existence are spontaneous laws, and he recounts the well and house came into his mind with an urgency and character of his own. Spirits may have participated, but his role was simply to fulfill the message's requirements. Respected for and sense of affinity with nature was also a trait Hazard shared with the transcendentalists.
So it says here, upon completion of his memorial tomb, it suddenly occurred, in quotes, to Hazard in 1883 that, quote, sometime or other a well would be needed by somebody after I am dead in the lot that is at the northeast corner of Gibson Ave and Hazard Ave. The site was the highest elevation on Seaside Farm and known to be underlain by granite ledge. And then it also says here, during the successful digging, it suddenly came to Hazard that he had been used by spirits, as are no doubt the water finders of the West. It then occurred to him that this well must be dug for some explicit purpose, though I could not then imagine what that might be. But I determined to build a stone house near the well and to name it Druid Stream. But for what purpose, I have never been able to determine to this day in June 1884, expecting that someone will need it. But who? I have never yet been able to imagine. He felt that spirits were probably instigating the building of the stone house I have determined to build, and in building, I had no motive nor could conceive of one. He goes on to say that the title Druid Stream applies to the locality, including the tomb, rather than to the house.
All right, so it says on page 8.5, a further comment records that, quote, suddenly flashed upon my mind that this house is to have a room in it that shall be carefully adapted to spiritual seances, especially for materializations. As far as the timeline goes, the document says Druid's dream was completed in the summer of 1884, but Hazard had stated in his diary that he never intended to live there, nor is there any evidence that he did. He died 8 years later in 1892 and was buried, not at his memorial tomb, but at a family burying ground at Vaucluse Estate in Portsmouth, Rhode Island. I think that's interesting. He went through all that trouble to build this elaborate burial site for himself and didn't use it.
Dedicated to the ancestors and his mother, Hazard Robinson Peace and Gibson, is now being built in 1849. It was 24 feet squared and to be 100 feet in height above the first floor and to be finished next summer.
Thomas R. Hazard, our old-time friend and correspondent, whose steadfast defense of the mediums of the new dispensation has rendered the name of Hazard a household word in all countries where spiritualism has found a foothold. And where has it not? So it sounds like he was traveling the world as a proponent of spiritualism.
Proponent of spiritualism.
Not just a practitioner.
And his name was a household word.
Thank you. What is this?
This is a well. It's been filled in and cemented over. I do believe it's a well, and what they might have done the days before refrigeration, they might have put ropes around this and maybe a canvas, and they might have used this as a well house in the summer to put dairy products and perishables, and the coolness of the water would have naturally preserved the dairy products and other perishables. That's what this might have been used for right here.
And the pillars, are they from the same time frame?
Yes. Yes, they are from the same time frame.
But they were set up because they were inspired, or Mr. Hazard was inspired by visiting Stonehenge, and then he came back and arranged this, correct?
Correct. That is correct. Stonehenge and other places, and he also spoke with people, was very heavily into spiritualism, and interviewed people at the time, religious people who were very much adept and scholared in the Druid religion. So I'm not sure of the actual significance of the alternate indentation. Must mean something though. Now supposedly he had this room in his house that was his own personal ritual chamber. I don't know how many participants he had, whether he had his own coven or whether it was his own to-do thing, but I've heard he had a pentagram painted on the floor, the whole thing decorated as a druidic, satanic chamber. This is what's been passed down. How much of it is true, we don't know. But you've done some research on that, correct?
We do know that he had a room, or a closet in a room, specifically set up for spiritualistic activities. So hopefully we'll find out some more about that when we read those memorandums.
Yeah, and I would be very surprised if he was doing this just completely by himself. Yeah. Keith mentioned the question of, was he involved with a coven? Well, my guess would be yes. I don't think he was doing this as an individual. I mean,
you would imagine.
He was certainly part of the spiritualist movement.
With his brother.
Understanding.
With his brother, yeah.
Would his brother be Shepherd Tom? Shepherd Tom Hazard?
Oh, I don't know. It says the Honorable Tom Hazard. I think some of
them
were
the judge. They went by different nicknames as well.
Yeah.
Yeah. I was just wondering, could there possibly be any connection with the Order of the Golden Dawn and Aleister Crowley, or did Joseph Hazard predate that? I think that he, his life ended around that time, kind of the cusp of that, to the 1890s, whereas Aleister Crowley would have been just coming into prominence.
You didn't see any?
Yeah, well, there was nothing in the diary about that. However, when he did visit with the Fox sisters, that was in 1848. Mm-hmm. So that was early on in his life.
Yes.
One of the things that we did find in the diary was, we don't think he thought very much of himself. He may have had a low self-esteem. Because we found a quote that says, "I have no hesitation in stating, in my 78th year, I feel quite sure I have never done anything in my life that was quite right." So he may have had a little bit of an esteem issue there.
My impression of him, this is one cool guy.
He's definitely interesting, yeah, yeah.
And yeah, but it's like we were discussing earlier. Would he have been viewed as being really cool if he did not have the money that he had? If he were not a wealthy person?
I don't know, but we did find in his diary, it was also a ledger. And he would put anything in that ledger, anytime he spent money, it was in that ledger.
Down to the penny.
Down to the penny.
Wow.
Down to the penny. And every page had entry upon entry upon entry of numbers. And I don't know why that is.
Many times we saw he bought stamps and he would record that. He bought stamps and then how much it cost.
Bought stamps. A lot of entries for buying stamps.
Definitely eccentric.
Yeah, definitely very eccentric.
But yeah, I think probably because he had money of his
actions. He was
actions
more respected instead of persecuted as he may have been.
Well, personally speaking, the last two times I was here in this location, I was here on December 6, 1973 with PYRO, Parapsychological Investigation and Research Organization. My brother Carl, our chairperson Donna, myself, another member, we investigated this place, and it was nighttime at the time.
And we talked to one of the local police officers who said that some of the neighbors report floating blue lights in the area at night, witnessing that. That's one of the phenomena they see. We came again at night with some other people. My brother Carl was with us, and we looked around and we didn't see anything out of the ordinary, but I know my friend Charles was with us, but it was, very cold and very still, nothing unusual. We just speculated on the druidic aspects of the place.
May I ask you, did they say what size, like the floating blue lights, or like, are we talking like teeny, or are we talking, you know?
No, just that they were visible. Just that they were visible and they saw them floating along. So big enough to be visible.
Now, to be honest with you, just looking around here, we're pretty much out in the middle of nowhere.
Yeah.
And it doesn't seem like there'd be anything natural that would be causing it.
I don't
think nothing man-made that would cause blue lights around here.
There's no power lines or anything.
There's no power lines, nothing.
It reminds me of the railroad tracks near the random dog track in the Bridgewater Triangle. They have floating blue lights around there. So is this on like a ley line type situation? Where long lines meet and the energy just builds up and turns into the blue light.
Good point. Very good point. Then
I think you should research that, Nathan.
Yeah.
I think so,
yeah,
too.
Send him out.
Because they've drawn the ley lines out. You just have to find a map and see if this runs through it.
Yeah.
That'll be interesting.
And that would make a lot of sense, because I know that they've done research where a lot of these structures are built in accordance with the ley lines.
With the ley lines, right.
Or could that energy have been attracted here because of people, so many people visiting here and perhaps holding rituals, believing this to be a sacred site?
Very well could be.
So Keith, do you know what's happened like since the 70s or maybe earlier than that to this location and how it's been used?
Well, I know it's a historic site. A lot of people have been doing archaeological research on this place. Also, at night, I'm sure there's been many, many groups that have come here and done cult activity. So that's been bringing in a lot of energy, negative or otherwise. But, there's also corpse lights, what they used to call it. In a cemetery, if a body was not buried too deeply, you would see perhaps some mist coming up from a grave. But I wouldn't think I know that it is very eerie. But considering the age of the cemetery here, you wouldn't be seeing that now. However, many pagan ceremonies have been conducted here over the years. I'm sure satanic and otherwise have been conducted here. And who knows?
Well, that's the first thing I thought. When we were walking in just now, there on the ground was a sign that someone had put up for a missing cat, and I'm like, oh. it made me think, could this place have been used for satanic worship on and off? I mean, I know that's probably not what it was built for initially, but people will make use of these sorts of locations.
I'm just glad there hasn't been more vandalism here, because people will take advantage of that, obviously. This is, this well is fairly recently, and within the last century has been filled in and cemented over, which is a good thing.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
But there is crime watch here, fortunately, at night. People sneaking in here and doing their rituals, and there's nothing wrong with people conducting their ceremonies, following their own personal beliefs, as long as they're respectful of the property and don't damage it, seize this for their own location.
And don't hurt the animals.
Oh, yes,
felines.
Definitely.
Hopefully that cat that we saw on the poster has been safely returned to his owner.
We hope
by
so.
Now.
We hope so.
Now, where is this chair that we talk about that's discussed? There's a chair?
Right in this vicinity. I was just going to look for it. Like I said, it's been the 1970s since I've been here, but I'm going to take a look for it. This
is what's referred to as the witch's chair. Some people call it the witch's altar, the druidic altar. Anyway, this is the witch's chair, as they say. Come on over and see. Now, Nathan, could you read what's on the back of this?
It has Joseph P. Hazard's initial, JPH, the year 1884, and the words Kendall's Green.
Does anybody want to try it on for size?
Okay, I'll be the guinea pig.
Go ahead, Nathan.
Let's get some shots.
Don't think you feel anything different in there.
We promise no harm shall come to you. You look ready for mummification. You're a natural.
Is it comfortable?
You! That is intimidating. You don't pick up any sensation at all while laying there, do you? How comfortable is that?
Pretty comfortable.
Could you fall asleep on it?
If I was tired enough.
And you wake up and everybody's gone. We've left you here.
Long walk back to Fall River. Next.
I think it was intended more for ritualistic purposes. I think I would hazard a guess that...
Oh my goodness.
That somebody, this was intended for somebody to sit here and maybe kind of go into their own dimension, their own separate world or something, or maybe glimpse another reality. Right now, the weather being what it is, it's, you could spend hours here and meditate and really go into another state of consciousness. I don't think this was intended for sacrificial purposes, however it may have been used as such.
Back in the day, you would have had a really good view from here of the circle before all the overgrowth.
And certainly in the fall and winter you would have a nice view even now.
Valerie, I wonder what impressions you would get from this, seeing that you're...
I find it a touch creepy.
Then again, you are very familiar with out-of-body experiences.
Yes. I would not choose to have one on this. It would be a bad one.
Well, let's see if you pick up anything just the same. Don't leave your body.
No. It is kind of comfortable, actually.
On my back. Get out my pocket watch and...
Yeah. No, there does seem to be a lot of energy here, you know?
Is that a military chop? Two military choppers?
Yeah.
We must be in double trouble.
They're looking for us.
Yeah. I wonder if there's anybody sensitive that could get a feeling from this. Well, you can't
I'm
really...
I'm sensing there was two males and a female here recently.
You are correct.
And a group of people just talking about it.
Let me go roll him and wait my idea.
But the thing is that stone, rocks like this, of these formations, do supposedly have recording properties, as Richard Felix, who you interviewed, would say. And
absolutely,
you know, it's Jesus said if the people were to be quiet, the rocks and stones themselves would cry out. Maybe that was literal, because rocks do have recording properties. Supposedly they can contain information that some people can decipher. When you experience a residual haunt, so to speak, it's because the recording properties in the rocks, for some unknown process, suddenly becomes generated, some electrical process, if you will, and you do actually experience a replay of an activity. So that would lend some validity to psychometry, wouldn't it?
It's in the idea behind the magnetic tape.
Exactly. I tell you, I'm getting some flashes, some scenes in my mind just looking at this, but I would attribute that to my imagination. Just thinking what may have transpired here.
Absolutely.
I was just doing a little research back at the pillar circle, and the convex pillars are north, south, east, and west, and the concave ones are on the alternate points of the compass.
Is that so? Oh,
yeah.
Okay.
Must have been intentional.
We're getting somewhere.
Also, looking at the convex ones, I wasn't thinking birdbath as much as I was thinking fireball.
Really? Like a little pyre there.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
That's very easy to picture.
Yeah. That'd look cool, too.
Just hope others don't get the same idea and start a forest fire around here.
Dan had mentioned that these pillars were in relation to the cardinal points of the compass. And we have found that, well, we've discovered that the convex stones are on the cardinal points of the compass, whereas the convex stones are 45 degrees off of that. So, in other words, we have this one at 90 degrees, that one's at approximately 160, and then 180, and then 230, 270, and so on and so forth. If that means anything, I don't know. But it's an interesting thing to note.
The fact that he dreamt this all up, this all came to him in a dream, and he decided that he had to build it, that to me is what's really cool.
It's weird. It's weird. I mean, why would you build something out of a dream?
Oh, I would love to, if I had money.
Yeah, and besides the fact that these make wonderful bird baths, they could have been used as kind of braziers that would just be an incendiary. And can you picture the whole ritual layout of this with the fires in the heyday when this was basically cleared out? And yeah, now all this extensive property that Joseph P. Hazard owned. I mean, Lord knows what went on here. Now, unfortunately, a lot of the ancient Druidic religion is lost to us because of the Roman invasions. They just basically obliterated their culture, wiped out their religion and their culture. In fact, they did a lot of
sacrifice. Is that part of the Christianity movement? Or?
Well, it was more like the Romans came in with their brand of paganism, and they steeped up their sacrifices to try to get the gods to ward off the Roman invasions. It didn't work, of course. The Romans took over. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, the new religion of Christianity took over the old religion. So the Druidism we have today is not really the ancient religion that the original Druids knew. Even Stonehenge, you know, the Druids adopted Stonehenge. That was not necessarily an original Druidic site. It was there, and the Druids took it over, you know, and it was not built for the Druids. It was some, you know, now the latest speculation is that it was a burial site itself, you know, originally. Mm. Could have been something to do with an observatory, you know, there's so many speculations.
Yeah. Yeah.
We'll never know for sure, but it's still our Stonehenge of the modern day.
Yeah.
We come here respectfully to explore the wonders of creation. We ask, who is here with us?
If there's someone here who is unseen, can you speak to us and give us proof of your presence?
We respectfully remember Joseph P. Hazard. Have any sacrifices taken place here?
How long have you been here?
How long has this well been here? Were there fires in the pillars?
What did you use this area for?
Do you remember Thursday evening, December 6, 1973? Do you like us being here?
What year is it?
Remember Thomas Hazard? Shepherd Tom?
Are we welcome here?
It's very peaceful here. Are we welcome to come back here?
I'm not sure if that was a voice in the distance. Did anybody hear something after your last question?
No.
No.
Nathan's out in the woods somewhere.
Where is he? Like way over there.
There's a little roadway back there. He went on that road.
Did you hear something?
Well, it sounded more like voices in the distance, but...
Well, what I was wondering is if this was ever officially a graveyard, would this have ever been consecrated, this ground ever been consecrated?
That's a good question. Very good question.
Well, and certainly not the whole area here, yeah. But certainly where the stones are and the people are actually buried, it's over in that section, right?
I would think so, yes.
I know the sign's out here, but
You want to give us a prayer before we leave, Keith?
Yes. In the name of our Father in Heaven, we came to this location with peaceful intent to explore the wonders of creation, and we leave in peace, taking nothing unholy with us, only that which is positive, angelic, protective, and of God's light. Amen.
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 Okay, so here we are at Rhode Island College. Time to go way back to Keith's roots to do some research and paranormal investigation, old school style.
Just like the good old days of parapsychological investigation and research organization, PIRO. We're here to research Joseph P. Hazard and his memorandum. Hopefully we can find out some more information about Druid's dream.
Absolutely.
According to this document, Joseph P. Hazard, when he retired only a few minutes before midnight, when he suddenly saw the spirit of Robert Burns standing in mid-air near the foot of his bed with eyes fixed on him, with a pleasant smile and a trimmed beard and a stiff woolen hat upon his head. And it gave him pleasure and comfort in his presence.
Well, we also know that he idolized Robert Burns from other documents that we have. He's quoted as saying he has followed poet Robert Burns from his cradle to his grave.
So this says here, so there was a change in the sound of the ticking, but not in the actual ticking, in the order of it. The watch having made a dozen ticks, a sharp snap occurs that sounds like the sudden breaking of a very hard and very dry stick of wood about the size of a knitting needle.
Well, Joseph Hazard was the sixth child of Roland Hazard and Mary Peace Hazard. But citing his lack of competence in business, however, Hazard abandoned his factories in 1845 and began to devote his time to travel, the study of spiritualism, and the construction of his home, the castle, and the Druid Dream House, both in Narragansett, Rhode Island, and a memorial tower at Tower Hill in South Kingstown, Rhode Island. Okay, what we have found here is mention of Kendall Green and the actual the tomb. It says, upon Kendall Green, I have erected an expansive tomb of westerly granite, which is actually westerly pink granite. Nathan, look what I have in my hand. I have the bill of sale stating that Mr. Joseph P. Hazard bought of Richard Harrell the monuments that make up the circle at Druid's Dream, the Druid Circle.
So this whole book is a record of Joseph Hazard's watch ringing. And in it, he basically, it documents every single night what the watch did. But it does say that I think he used it as a way to communicate with spirits. He had a certain ring for his mother, so he, you know, when it made that ring, he would think his mother was around. It looks like he would place the ring in the center of a table, and we don't know if that was during the seances or not, but he does indicate in here that he did have a lot of visitations from spirits. Nothing about the actual Druid stream, though, unfortunately.
Okay, what we have here is a painting that was done by one of Joseph Hazard's relatives here in the special collection section of the Rhode Island College Library, the Adams Library. And we were interested to, it was interesting to note that the painting itself kind of has a similarity to the what do they call it, the circle there, the circle down at the Druid's Dream, where they have the eight cardinal points and with a male figure in the center where the wellhead would be. So we don't know if there's a connection here with this mandala to the monument that's down there or not, but it just is very, very interesting. One of the other interesting facts about this painting is that the famous psychologist Carl Jung took a look at this photograph or this painting, and Carl Jung is noted for his interpretations of paintings like this as far as dreams go and spiritualism and that type of thing.
Symbolism.
And symbolism. So it's very interesting. Very, very interesting. Look at these. There's a crown here. There's a star. There's a heart. This looks like, I don't know what that is. There's different items in this paint. We're going to have to study this some more. Isn't that interesting? Look, the stars at the cardinal point. This represented the compass. See it?
Here we all are together. We've done extensive investigations on Druid's Dream, the site and its history, and also on the life and journals of Joseph Peace Hazard. We've seen some amazing things and come with some amazing information, some that I didn't expect we'd ever come across.
got more than we bargained for. What do you guys think? What we came up with? Nathan, you were there. You were there on site. What did you think of that location while you were there?
Fascinating. There's Druid's Dream, the house he built, and then across the street, the Kendall Green.
Mm-hmm.
That he says he built it for children, but right now it's just eight pillars in a circle, and then you have the Druid's chair off to the side.
Yes, and that, of course, all came to him in a dream. He was told to build it. He wasn't sure why he dug that well or why he built it in the first place. He was just driven to build it. He knew it had some purpose that would be realized perhaps years down the line.
Reminds me of the Winchester house that was built because of spirit
involvement. Right. That was under spirit direction. Of course, Joseph Hazard really had no realization as to exactly what the purpose was, whereas the Winchester house, there was a purpose to it. He just knew it had to do with spiritualism, of which he was quite a proponent and follower. And the castle itself was built with spiritualism in mind. Dave, what are your reflections on that?
Well, it was interesting. We looked at information from three different sources. We went to the Rhode Island Historical Society Library, we went to the Rhode Island College Library, and we went to the Peacedale Library in Rhode Island. And we found a wealth of information. Unfortunately, we never did find an entry in any of his diaries or any of his papers about why he built Druid's Dream. We just know, you know, from knowledge that he built it because he had a dream about it. But nothing in his diary about why. He does mention it in several places, but that's the extent of it, and there's really no reason, you know, given other than what we know already. So, but we did find out a lot of information. Like you said, he was heavily into spiritualism. He actually spent time with the Fox sisters up in New York, who were the, what do you want to call them, the founding fathers or the founding sisters of
spiritualism.
That's right. So he was, you know, and according to some of the documents, the Hazard name was a household name in spiritualism at that time, which I had no idea. I had never heard of them. So that was an interesting thing to find out. But again, you know, it's just strange that we don't know anything about why he actually built Druid's Dream.
Janine, could you go into some more detail about the actual manifestations that occurred there during those seances?
Sure. From what we saw, he was actually writing in his diary and in other places that he, during some of the seances with his brother Thomas, that many spirits would appear, including Thomas's deceased wife and daughters, one of whom, at one of these seances, was able to make it so that her hair could be cut with scissors, and then she was able to rub it between her hands somehow, and then give the hair plus a piece of lace from a scarf that she was wearing to Joseph Hazard. And he, years later, he still comments on how he still has them. How that was able to happen, I have no idea.
Sounds very much like Katie King, that these manifestations appear in this physical form, and they're actually able to cut their hair and give apports that are physical manifestations of them.
I hadn't heard of that story, but that's what it does sound like. He did use a medium during his seances. In this particular one, he calls her Mrs. H. So we don't know if somehow the medium was playing a trick on him. He was very good at trying to debunk things as well. From what we know about how he built the room, he made it so it was very difficult. Like, they did a lot of knocking and rapping and things like that. He made sure that him and his brother were the only ones near the table, things like that he could control to try to minimize whether or not they were having, like, the wool pulled over their eyes. Mm-hmm.
Like Houdini tried to do.
In a way, yes. I think Joseph was a little bit more accepting of things and didn't get into it that much. Although later on I read that he does get into his own theory about what this whole spiritual realm was and how it worked. He talks about electricity and magnetism, and he talks about wanting to get chemists involved and people who know pyrotechnics, because there were a lot of incidences during the seances where they would see sparks. He knew it wasn't electricity, and he knew it wasn't anything to do with fire, because they would be very close to the people in the seance, and there was no burning or anything like that. So, but he did have an interest in getting the scientific community involved, although I don't think, from what I've read, that that ever happened.
Mm-hmm. Valerie, when we were at the location of Druid's Dream, of course, you sat in what's known today as the witch's chair. What were your impressions of that, sitting there in that location?
In that wooded area, that's probably the creepiest place mm-hmm. there. Although my research shows that druids did not actually do human sacrifice. So I don't think that any of that was done there, but who knows what might have been done. I'm sure that they did a lot of different type of rituals there.
Mm-hmm. Did you think you, like, maybe picked up on anything or felt anything in relation to sitting there?
There was a different energy there.
Uh-huh.
There was. I mean, I'm certainly not a psychic, but you can feel energy, you know? And the energy definitely changed there. You were there at the time, too. Did
yes.
you think it was a different energy there?
I felt it was very, very... Well, there was a lot of foliage. It was very heavily oxygenated. It was seemed to be a very spiritual place. And, of course, the last time I was there was back in the 1970s, and I was there with PYRO, Parapsychological Investigation and Research Organization, quite a few years ago. That was in the wintertime. But here we are when it's very, very overgrown and quite a peaceful setting. And, of course, in Joseph Hazard's day, it was very, very clear, as we've seen from that illustration. Nathan, what's your impression of that place?
I thought it was a very interesting place. Like, some of the cindler poles around in the circle were either convex or concave. He says in his writings, the ones that catch the water is for birds, but who knows the purpose of why it was concave or convex.
I did a little bit of research actually on that, because I was interested in the fact that there are 8 pillars mm-hmm. And that there were 4 that were, you know, convex and 4 that were concave. It turns out that the number 8 comes up a lot in Druidism. Particularly, there are 8 festivals every year. 4 are solar and mm-hmm. 4 are lunar. So that mm-hmm. might have something to do with, you know, the convex and concave. They might be representative of the 8 festivals. There are also 8 elements, 8 main elements of Druid belief. Sacredness of all life, the other world, reincarnation, nature, healing, journey, as in life's journey, potential, as in developing one's potential, and magic. So they might have also, each pillar might partly represent one of the main Druidic beliefs.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Nathan, I wanted to ask you, you did a little bit of cemetery legend tripping on your own as part of the research for this project. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
A little bit. I can tell you that there's 2 rows of 7 plots, and the people who are buried there are Joseph himself, his parents, most of his siblings, and most, if not all, of his brother Thomas's kin are buried in that cemetery in Portsmouth in Newport County, Rhode Island.
Which is interesting, because there's documentation, almost a will, if you want to look at it that way, where Joseph wanted to be buried, he wanted to be cremated, which was a very unusual thing at the time when he died. And there was only one place that actually did it in the United States. but he wanted to be cremated and then have his ashes spread around the circle. And actually, when you look at it now, you see the eight pillars and what's left of the well, but there was a monument on top of that. And he had it inscribed and everything with his information, and he had intended to have his ashes strewn about there and then update the monument. But for some reason, that monument was taken down and they buried him in Portsmouth, probably to be with the rest of the family, but I believe it was against his own wishes.
Now, it's interesting, the Rhode Island Historical Cemetery database says that there are 9 people buried in that cemetery. Mm-hmm. And it says that they are in urns encased inside the pillars. But we can't find any evidence of anybody being buried inside those pillars. There's no inscriptions or anything. And they also say that, you know, there are 9 people buried there, but they don't give any names at all. So whether there are actually people buried there or not, I don't know.
Certainly not your typical New England historical cemetery,
is it? No, definitely not.
And it's funny because he's quoted as saying that he didn't realize until after he put the pillars in that it formed a Druid circle. But according to what Valerie found out, it does seem like there was a little bit of that intention in the way that he built it.
And Druids do rituals around a Druid circle. I've seen some pictures of Druid circles.
Right.
On the internet.
Yeah. I was just wondering, is there any evidence at all that Joseph Hazard and some of his associates actually held Druidic rituals at that site or in the castle?
I never found anything.
I never found anything except the fact that he admits to seances and those type of things, but nothing on Druidic activity.
Mm-hmm. But that doesn't mean people years later use the site for that purpose or such purposes.
Mm-hmm. I'd be surprised if people hadn't. I'm sure it's still used to this day.
I'd be surprised if he hadn't, I would think he would have.
But we don't see any evidence. I mean, we were all there in the circle and around the circle, and we didn't find any garbage or any remnants of people being there, you know. So it's not to say that it hasn't happened, but it didn't look like there was any recent activity anyway.
All right. David, in your research, you came across an excerpt in his journal near the end of his life where he speaks of never having done anything right. Could you elaborate on that?
Yeah, it basically said that it sounded like he sort of had a kind of a low self-esteem or maybe a low, not such a great vision about what he did in his life. He does speak of the fact that he didn't think he did anything right in his life. So, you know, I was kind of upset with that because he actually did a lot. He was a world traveler. He went to, we found countries such as Calcutta, India. We found he'd been to Japan. He had been to England. He spent a lot of time in England. He was all over Europe. So I can't see why he would say that he didn't feel that he had done anything right in his life.
Well, I can understand why he might be depressed because he witnessed most of his siblings die before him, and I think all of Thomas's children before he passed away. So he might have been depressed because
He might be depressed because of that, but he didn't have any influence on that, obviously. You know, he couldn't have had any influence on that. So
I actually read somewhere that Thomas looked forward to dying because he wanted to cross over and be with his family, and he was ready and willing to be on that spiritual realm because he believed in it so much from his experiences.
And well, if they were having physical contact with spirits, then certainly they know what's on the other side.
That's true.
And they felt so strongly that the other side was actually there that Joseph actually would leave food in rooms for the spirits to eat at night. You know, he'd put the food in the room and close the door.
They were that real to him.
Yeah.
Food for the day. Real.
Yes.
Food for the day.
I wonder if he ever got up the next morning and it was gone. He doesn't write about that.
I don't know.
From what I found out was the castle was built on purpose to be 105 feet high, and it's actually a memorial to his ancestors, mostly his mother. And on the third floor, there he actually had a pink marble plaque put in with a lot of his family information on there. And in that will that I mentioned earlier, it does say that he wanted that updated with his information as well when he passed. So whether that was done or not, we don't know because no one's been in there in a while.
And he left everything to his only living, or one of his living sisters, Anna.
Well, there's debate about that because we found that the Druid's Dream house was lived in later by his brother Roland's relatives or his lineage. So whether it went to Anna or it went to Roland, we're not sure. I've seen accounts of both, so.
I'm wondering how much of a connection is there with Druid's Dream and Stonehenge in England?
From what I saw, he, and Dave probably spoke on this earlier, Joseph Hazard went to London quite a lot. He actually traveled the world all the time, and especially to London. And he went to see Stonehenge, and he was very impressed by that. And I think that was probably, if not one of the reasons he put the pillars in the way he did, that maybe in the back of his mind it was there. Because he was very impressed with Stonehenge.
Do you think there's actually a connection or an intended connection between Druid's Dream and Stonehenge? Like there's some kind of alignment there?
Well, Stonehenge and American Stonehenge in New Hampshire, they have at certain points during like the summer months, the sun will rise through this trail or a symbol they made out of stone. And maybe that's why there are pillars in the certain spots of the cardinal points.
That's what I was wondering. That's what I was getting at.
And then you have the tower down
the Newport Tower. Yes. The
Newport Tower is claimed to be, or some people believe is an old, what is it? I can't think of the name of it, but the it's an old church.
Mm-hmm.
It's
an old site.
I've heard a lot of claims. Vikings.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah, Vikings and, what's the gentleman's name that came across and did all kinds of weird stuff? Anyway, there's a lot of strange connectivity to all of this.
Yeah.
So
I had read a reference to Stonehenge that Druids apparently do a summer solstice.
Yes.
Summer solstice ceremony at Stonehenge.
Well, that was kind of what I was getting at.
Mm-hmm.
The summer solstice, the winter solstice.
Those are the solar festivals there. Those are like the two main solar festivals.
Is there a connection?
Are of the eight.
Mm-hmm.
Sorry. The same thing with Newgrange in Ireland.
Mm-hmm.
There's a little window where I think it's the winter solstice. That light can come in through that little window and light up the entire inside of that dolmen, I guess it's called. He did, like Dave said, he traveled the world looking for this type of connection to the spirit realm. I mean, there's one story, he was in Calcutta and he was listening to a musician that would take these two trumpets and put them next to his throat and music would come out even though he wasn't blowing into them. And he wow. writes how it had to be spirits that were making this music. So that's just one example. I mean, there's tons of stories of all the different places where he went looking for this type of activity. So I can just imagine him attending some kind of ritual at Stonehenge during his travels, because he did go out looking for that type of stuff.
And for a spirit connection, the famous Palatine Light, he saw that, he witnessed to that. It appeared to him like a ship on fire. In a few days after, a terrible northeast gale would happen, and that's typical for that type of phenomena of the Palatine Light. off of Block Island.
Sort of a precursor of something right, bad like a to harbinger. Come.
Yes. Yes, and he'd
like
actually...
the Mothman.
Exactly, like the Mothman. You know, it's like, I still, with all his adventures, with all the... and he did live to be, a ripe old age. He was in his 80s, and died on January 18th, 1892. Somehow I get the impression in his writings that he felt unfulfilled with all that he lived. He felt unfulfilled.
Yeah, I agree.
Well, he never married, although he does write about having a love affair, but I guess nothing ever. He actually found it funny that he had a love affair. Uh-huh. You know, I'm not sure why that was amusing to him, but actually, if you look at his family, I think only three of them married out of the nine children.
A lot of them didn't marry, which is unusual.
But I think he spent a lot of his time traveling and in his later life looking into spiritualism and what it meant. He also had a pretty good connection with his mother. And there is a book that is this thick, and I can tell you that it's going to be smaller than a 5-point font. It very small writing, where he had a pocket watch, and it was a very expensive pocket watch. It cost him thousands of dollars, even back in the 1800s. And he would sleep with it cupped in his hand at night underneath his ear. And he would talk to it and try to get it to make clicks because when he was very ill, he says that the clock or the pocket watch started making odd noises. So he took it to a medium, and the medium told him, oh, that click is for your mother. So he thought it was a way to speak to his mother. And every day he would write, the morning when he woke up, he would write in this diary, the pocket watch clicked 3 times, or the pocket watch clicked 4 times, and I saw the apparition of my mother, and talk about the story. So that was his big thing. It was almost an obsession, the amount of detail that he would go into. There were different clicks for different people, and he would go into how the sound of each of the clicks was different. Mm-hmm. If he ever told someone today about this, they might think he was crazy, but... You know, he completely believed it, and he documented it, you know, in the greatest amount of detail.
He was very obsessive with a lot of his writings as well. Throughout all his documentation, we find that he's telling us the same story maybe 5 times during the course of a book. Mm-hmm. And he writes it all in different places, and, you know, you go from one library to the other, and you find the same story in another document in another library, so... he was obsessed with continuing to tell us different, you know, the same story over and over and over, you know, about different things. It wasn't just one particular subject. So, uh-huh.
And part of that might have been because he didn't know what was going to survive, so he would put it in different places.
That's possible.
But I think part of it was that he wanted to make sure that somebody knew what happened to him.
Does anybody know what happened to this pocket watch? Did that survive?
No idea. Mm. There is an interesting connection between the Hazards and psychiatrist Carl Jung as well. There is some belief in some of the documentation that Roland Hazard, who was the person who lived in Druid's Dream, he was going through some issues. And there's a question as to how long it was. Some people say it was a few months. Some people say it was a year that he spent with Carl Jung. And people who know Carl Jung know that he was... even though he trained under Sigmund Freud, his way of thinking of psychology was looking at it through spiritualism, understanding of dreams and their meaning, what they meant to people. And so it's interesting that this family of spiritualists are connected to someone like Carl Jung. And we found out at the Rick Library, well, actually, right when we were getting ready to leave, there was a mandala on the wall. And I guess Carl Jung, in his practice, used to have people draw or paint these mandalas so he could analyze them. So they would be based on their dream, and then they would take them to him, and he would analyze them. But the one that was hanging on the wall at the Rick Library was from one of the Hazard relatives. I'm not sure where along the line, but... And the picture, it looks like, I mean, if you look at it, there's 8 points, which could correspond to the Druid Circle at Druid's Dream, and there's a person in the middle, kind of, look, you know, reaching out or whatever. But you have to wonder how far down the family tree did this belief system go? You know, if there were family who were living in either the castle or the Druid's Dream home, how much were they influenced? What was going on in that house? You know, if he was holding seances every day, you know, from the way we look at things, what kind of activity was going on in that house? You know, is there still activity today? The people who live there say no. But while his ancestors or his relatives were living there, what were they going through on a daily basis?
Mm-hmm. They were probably quite the ghost magnets.
You would think so.
Well, when you say that there was activity taking place, that may be true, because we do know that in 1951, at the castle, the Catholic Church had bought the castle, and they did perform an exorcism in the castle. So why they did that is, I'm sure that they believed that there was activity going on in there, and they wanted to get rid of it. It was used as a spiritual center for the Catholic Church for many years.
Mm-hmm. It wasn't an exorcism over a person. It was actually an actual house or home exorcism.
I think it was a home exorcism, yes.
Is this documented?
It is. It's online. Yeah, you can find it online. We did find it there.
And we wonder if they're the ones that closed up the tower or not.
Mm-hmm. You know. It's a possibility.
So here we have a documented exorcism.
A documented exorcism.
History of spiritualism.
Yeah.
Druidic practices. And a wonderful, wonderful piece of history for Rhode Island, and I think for the whole United States, even though most of the United States is not yet aware of this treasure that we have here. Although I have the feeling we were being watched.
By a deer.
I think
right
they're onto us.
Exactly. I think they may be onto us.
I would have to say that if anybody wants to go visit these buildings, I think they're more than welcome to, but please be respectful of
exactly
the areas. They are absolutely gorgeous buildings.
Beautiful.
Beautiful grounds.
And Druid's Dream itself.
Druid's Dream is beautiful. Druid's Dream is actually a business now. It's a bed and breakfast, and people need to be respectful of those businesses.
We all are looking to learn more about Druid's Dream and the purpose that Joseph Hazard was behind. What drove the man? What drove his family? What was his purpose? What was his mission? Why is his mission still ongoing today? Why are we there? You know, questions that we want answers for. And I think it will just, we'll just continue to get more answers, more questions.
I feel that, and I don't know how the rest of the team feels about this, but when I left the Adams Library at Rhode Island College, I felt as though fate brought us to this, and we have to continue on with this to discover what all this means. Mm-hmm. You know, it was just the strangest feeling seeing the Mandela, and you felt like you were looking into the circle when you saw that picture. It was very life changing.
Did you almost feel like it was an overhead of the Druid's Dream site itself?
Exactly, exactly.
Mm-hmm. But it's interesting that a relative of his would have that in a dream. You know, did the dream somehow transpire through his family somehow? It's actually very unusual for all of this documentation on spiritualism to exist today. Because, for one, yes, they were a wealthy family, but a lot of wealthy families and families in general would throw away things like this on spiritualism because it wasn't widely accepted. I mean, it's not really widely accepted today, but even more so then. So we read somewhere that many people who did write about things like this, their work doesn't exist anymore. It was thrown away. The fact that there's so much information, that Joseph himself was so diligent about writing all of this and making sure that he documented everything, and then his family, through Roland Hazard and the rest of them, the fact that these documents survived and have been preserved and cared for, I think, is a treasure in Rhode Island, if not to kind of the spiritualist movement in general.
Mm-hmm. I agree.
And there's a lot more to uncover.
I think you've all done a wonderful job of uncovering what you all have and what we've explored and found so far, and the beauty of this spot and the fantastic story that is Joseph P. Hazard and what his quest and his mission was. Your treks into the woods, being injured and blazing the trail there. We appreciate that, Nathan. Yes, we do. We appreciate
intrepid explorer,
exactly. We appreciate all Lynn D. did as well, and all of us together. I think we've come across some pretty amazing information and discoveries.
But it doesn't end here.
No, it does not.
It does not.
We put our blood, sweat, and tears into this.
Yes.
Nathan's blood.
David's tears.
David's tears.
Yes, exactly. Sandra, your impressions.
My impression, the only thing I want to say is when we first decided that we were going to do that, I mean, we've been discussing possibly looking into the Druid's Dream idea and doing a show around the location for quite some time now, and we kept putting it off, and then we finally did it. And I'm just incredulous to the amount of information that our crew was able to research and come up with, because I was very dubious. I really did not think that there was going to be that much that we would be able to dig up. I mean, I'd heard about the location. I thought that was it. It was the man and his bunch of stones, and that was it.
But now you know much more.
Now I know. I've been educated. It's been an education, and it's been very interesting.
And now you know the rest of the story.
I know the rest of the story.
Almost the rest.
Actually, no, you know, my gut story. Feeling is that there, as everyone else has said, we've really just scratched the surface, and there's something else. It may even be staring us right in the face, but there is something else.
I had no idea there was any connection with Carl Jung at all, how extensive this was, or that Joseph Hazard had ever visited Stonehenge and done research there and taken this back with him, that there was that much of a connection. The mystery just keeps getting deeper and deeper, and you just want to know more and more. I just really think that even today there is some kind of connection with those ancient times, with the area that is Stonehenge, and this place in Narragansett, Rhode Island. I just have this feeling there is some kind of connection, and somebody knows something more, and that we're getting closer and closer to that. That's what I'm taking away from this.